Okay, we are getting ourselves ready to go, and you guys are here already. Jamie, they're here with us already.
We get at least two. That's why I was hoping for two viewers this time.
They're coming in as we speak, and we'll give people a couple of minutes to get started, and then I'll let Deeks take it away. We are in the back room at Country Garden, and the back building, right, where we hope it's going to be nice and quiet for Deeks's presentation. And let me just say to all of you who have not been on one of these virtual talks before, that if you have questions, please go to the chat bubble that's at the bottom of your screen and type your question into chat, and it will come up on the side. I will see it. And then toward the end, or if it pertains to something in the middle of the presentation, I'll alert Deeks and he will answer your questions. So know that whatever your questions are about your lawn, Deeks is happy to answer them, and we'll kind of go through the presentation first, and you put questions in chat, and then we will take them as they appear. I know that you have an option at the bottom of your screen to raise your hand. Don't do that, because just type it into chat, because there are only so many things that we can monitor at one time, and we've chosen to monitor the chat and answer your questions that way. So it is 4 o'clock. I'm going to get my picture off the screen, and Deeks, you're going to take it away and let people know what they need to know right now about their lawns.
Thank you, CL. Hey, everybody. Thanks for joining me. It's been a tough year for lawns. You know, we did good up until, you know, end of June, July kind of time frame when it got a little warm. So everybody seems to be struggling. It's the common question that I'm getting right now is how do I fix my burned out lawn? So this is kind of what we're choosing to go with this time for our talk, and be nice to me because I don't do the PowerPoints very often. This is number two. So boom. Oh yeah. Look at that. Like magic right now happening. Okay. So we know that, and you know, everybody, because we have water bands and stuff to different levels, everybody's got a different, you know, they've been watering in different ways. So sometimes you can get through the summer like that, and sometimes you can't. So we've got a few examples here of different, you know, levels of how screwed up something is. This is minimally screwed up. This isn't bad. So, I mean, this, you know, easy to fix, might come back, that kind of deal. You get a little toastier, you start looking like this, and that's not ideal. You know, nobody wants their lawn looking like that. And then when it gets real bad, then you get into this kind of territory. So, I mean, a lot of people honestly have burned out lawns. So it's one of the things is our summers here are really hot. So our grasses are cool weather, and the way they survive the heat is by going dormant. So typically they are going to go brown. They're going to put their energy into their roots, and they're going to kind of, you know, if you're not watering or anything, they're just going to turn brown and kind of chill out till it gets cooler. The problem happens is basically if your roots get this deep and you let your soil dry out to below the roots will hang in there for a little bit, but they're going to die out. So if the soil gets dried out deeper than your root structure, then you're going to start losing your grass. Cape Cod is notorious for a very tight soil. So we have a very compacted soil structure. So in a lot of instances with traditional means, especially where we are encouraging or you know, certainly not discouraging a very, very tight soil structure. So it's incredibly difficult to get roots to grow through that soil because there's no air, and the roots are growing through the air in the soil, not pushing the soil apart. They're just trying to find the cracks and crevices and going down that way. So the more air in the soil, ultimately the deeper we can get our roots to grow. So if we're trying to get through periods of drought, you know, extended like we are, the best friend that we have is air to depth in soil. So our main strategy here, and there's a few different ways of achieving this, but ultimately we're just trying to get the soil fluffier, and then we're going to work on better water structures so that you can, you know, work the roots deeper in the soil. It doesn't help to have a lot of air in the soil if we water every day or every other day. If roots are here, we don't want to put water here, which is what we tend to do. You know, that's one thing that leads us into trouble in the summertime as well, as we go from watering maybe once a week, And then as it starts to warm up and get hot, then we go to every couple days or every 3 days or whatever. And essentially, if our roots have gotten this deep with our infrequent watering, and then we put the water here consistently, roots aren't going to, they're not going to stay. They're just going to kind of go up to where the water is. So they're going to be lazy roots. And then that's going to dry out way faster. So when we try and help and we put the water on to kind of keep it out of its stress, it's essentially going to stress it out a little bit more. So we can, you know, with better cultural practices, we can kind of get things to go a little bit deeper and have an easier time of, or more likelihood of it surviving one of these droughts like we're getting now. Last couple of years have been pretty tough, and it's pretty common now to see people's lawns just a hot mess. You know, this is a nice lawn, but it's still, you know, the edges where it gets hot, it's not so happy. So even a lawn like this, where it's just minimal, we can still apply the same kind of practices that we'll talk about to kind of pep this up a little bit and get this to do a little bit better. But where it's really hot, we struggle. You know, full sun lawns, they're always going to struggle a little bit more than the shade lawns will. It's just how it is. And especially when you have a really hot surface, like your, you know, walkway or a driveway, then it's going to tend to fry that lawn out a little bit more around the edges. So you might have to do a little more consistent work in those type of areas. So this is one that I did. This was this time last year, maybe a week or two earlier, but essentially fried out, had a little disease, wicked tight soil. That was it like a month later. And that is it right now. So you can kind of still see along the edges, it's struggling a little bit. And there's definitely some hot spots in the middle there that you can't really see where the grass is struggling. But all in all, he's doing way better than he was doing last year. So what we did for this lawn was compost. And that got, we smothered everything. So put 1.5 inches of material, which is essentially 4.6 yards per 1,000 feet of compost on top, killed everything, reseeded, which gave us that a month later, and then to that. So that was his grass, right? And that's essentially what most people are looking for. Most people want straight grass. Now, grass isn't your only option, right? But we're not going to talk about that yet. So we're going to talk about top dressing with compost first. So that's a couple piles of compost, and that's basically the process. And that's his really jacked up pitchfork. That's definitely the heads on the wrong way. That's one of my favorites. And his pitchfork's still like that. I'm pretty sure that to this day, that pitchfork is still flipped around like that. So it's not one I would use, but it's fantastic to make fun of. But essentially, you put that compost in the wheelbarrows and you run around and you drop piles. When you're doing, you know, 1.5 inches like this was, a couple inches, you're not really worried about spreading it out super, you know what I mean? Like, you're just kind of making it flat, smooth it out. You're going to kill everything anyway. So if you got a little bit heavier in some spots than others, it's not a super big deal. So this is one way of doing compost, which is like that one. We kind of killed everything, right? So this is putting a couple inches of material on top of the lawn, which was what my lawn was last fall. And that was an all crabgrass lawn. So I did hit it with a torch. I didn't have to, but I just felt like burning the stuff. So I burned everything real quick. And then I put the compost down. This is like 1/2 inch of compost. So not everybody's really bad. And if you've got a good, you know, if your lawn's still doing pretty good, but you've got the, you know, weak spots in there, it's thin in some spots, you want to do some reseeding. We definitely don't recommend topsoil or loam. That stuff's just going to make your soil tighter. There's no real fluffiness in it. Anybody that's put in, you know, a few inches of loam and then gone back to that soil the next year, it's hard as a rock. Sometimes just a few months later, but essentially that soil just compresses and all the air comes out of it, and you're just left with, you know, really, really tight soil structure that doesn't grow things well. So compost is always the better, you know, alternative if you're trying to make soil better. If you're trying to, you know, improve things, you want to use compost. If you're filling a hole or changing grade, by all means, use your topsoil, but then you'd still want to top dress with compost after that. So this is 1/2 inch of compost. It's kind of typical to what you'd look like. You might see a little bit more brown than this with a real 1/2 inch. This looks pretty light. But essentially, you're going to get some little bits of green that grow up through there, and you're going to get large areas of brown where the compost is. You pretty much want to cut your lawn short before you do this. If you're going to smother it, you know, if you're going to kill everything, it doesn't really matter. Let it grow long. It's just all food, whatever. You can cut it short if you want, but it's not a super big deal. When you're dealing with trying to make the soil better and not kill things, so that 1/2 inch, you want to cut the lawn short before you do it. So essentially you want spikier grass. So the material is going to sit on it and the grass is going to come up through. when you're smothering stuff, if it doesn't matter, because you're putting that on the tall grass, whatever, it's going to smother it and it's going to die either way. So, but when you're trying to keep things alive, definitely mow it pretty short, have that spiky grass, and then that grass will kind of come right up through. So if you're not going to smother most of it, as long as you keep to that half of an inch, you'll always kill some stuff because soil isn't super consistent. You're always going to have little bumps and stuff, and your, you know, grading rake is however big, anything that's kind of, you know, you could easily see how that could smother some things. So you always overseed when you do it either way. And essentially just hammer with some compost and put some grass seed down. We hit it with biology, which is pretty fun. So clover, some people hate clover. That's my clover lawn. That's clover and grass. That's maybe 3 weeks ago. It's not super fair because I water my lawn probably once a week, and the lady on the left of that doesn't water at all, really. Her lawn's established for years. I'm pretty sure that thing's dead this year, though. That one in the back, the field, it doesn't get watered either, but it always comes back. It's like 40 years of just mulching grass and leaves into that thing. It never gets fertilized. None of that action never gets watered. But the roots on that lawn are deep enough that it can survive that soil drying out to that point. So it does pretty good. It hasn't failed yet. So clover, I'm kind of digging. I, to be real, I didn't like it at first. You know, it, when I put this in last fall, this was 3 days, 4 days after I put it down, maybe five, you know, right after I did it. But essentially everything kind of last fall stayed pretty small. It didn't really explode. It filled in real nice, but it didn't push top growth, right? So one of the things that happens with the attack strategy that we recommend here, or at least I'm recommending here, is you're doing more pushing roots than top growth. So I didn't really get the results visually on top that a lot of people will do if they're using like the synthetics that are going to push that growth. It still came in nice. It just didn't explode. The spring didn't really explode right off the bat. But once the forsythia bloomed to fall, this thing just took off and the clover exploded, the grass exploded, everything just, you know, it just kind of, the roots were big enough and strong enough that it just pushed a ton of top growth. So I had a really lush lawn, which was kind of what that is, right? So that's like a month after, and you kind of see it's a frumpy thing. It definitely wasn't, you know, all at the same length, and I kind of just let it go to see what it would do. But essentially the mini clover just filled in where the grass wasn't doing good. So where grass started to struggle, like with the guy that drops the mail off right along the front there, brought in, I think, Pythium, but it just kind of along the road for this lawn, it ended up being a little tore up. And, you know, this is it, I think 2 days ago, right? Which looks amazing. It's amazing for me. That's all I want. But then you pull back a little bit and yeah, there's still some trouble. So, you know, even though you've got a really gorgeous lawn and it's coming in really nice, there's always going to be something that'll throw you a curveball. So this is where it's really hot. And I think that disease that came from near the road worked its way around on the hot areas. And I also don't water this thing very well. I have to move the sprinkler around. It's not my house. So it's just one of those things that I kind of put off. So this would be the area that really doesn't ever get the water that it should. So it's like there's always going to be that little bit of a curveball that you're going to have to deal with. For me, I'm just going to throw a little material, a little compost on it, throw some seed, and just make sure I keep this part wet this fall. And then it'll catch up to the rest of it. But all in all, I'm really happy with how this thing came out. I don't do anything. Like I said, I'm watering maybe every 5 or 6 days, if I remember. And there's a guy that parks his truck over there that leaves his window open. So I'm always going to say, I never water it. Just it gets neglected. So if you actually take care of it, it's going to come out a lot better than this. And understandably, you know, with this kind of a summer, considering it was put in last fall, it takes more work than it would if this was established. You know, if we get this lawn a few years in, its roots are going to be really deep. It's going to be pretty set. I shouldn't have to deal with, you know, too much moving forward. Mini clover is great at smothering things. I had sorrel all over the front corner of that, and it's gone. The mini clover just took care of it. That sorrel lived through the torch and 2 inches of compost. So sorrel came right back up this spring and last fall. And that mini clover kind of smothered it right as soon as it popped, which I was ecstatic with. Because I really don't use any weed killers. We use a weed popper, which is really awesome. This lawn had gotten one tub of microorganisms and one bag of ProGrow over the fall when I installed it and this spring, and that was really it. I started experimenting with this other guy's stuff, which I'm going to throw him a plug because this is fantastic. This guy is the Fish Brew guy, and I'm pretty sure they're over Barnstable. They have a hatchery, like a fish. They got a fish thing, and they use the fish waste. This is bio from that 10,000 feet. So kind of similar to this thing, but just you don't know is what's in this one a little bit. This one's more of like a rifle. You know exactly what you got. It's like honed in on what you're dealing with. This is like a shotgun. You're just putting a whole bunch of microorganisms, protozoa, all kinds of fun stuff at the soil. It's the same kind of deal. But this is $25 for 10,000 feet. The stuff's $35 for 10,000 feet. But this is a really good one. I'm having fun trying it out. So essentially, the way that we're getting the air in these soils and the way that we're getting these lawns to stay green is with worms, right? So this is where the synthetic guys, you kind of get left behind. Like as much as I want to put air in your soil too, all the salts that we use traditionally, all the products there, herbicides, the insecticides, the fun, all that stuff kills the good guys that make soil food. So when we talk about like this stuff or the bioremedy, you're essentially putting microorganisms in root mass. So roots are pooping, these things eat what the roots poop, the carbohydrates and sugars and stuff. And then they colonize around the root mass. They live in the soil around the root mass and they chew things up and make those things into food for the plant. Worms eat them. So the more biomass you build in the soil, the more worms you'll come to live there. So essentially like that front lawn that you're looking at, it's surrounded by road or driveway. There's no path to this soil, but that is full of earthworm castings where it had none last year. So it was crabgrass and really hard, tight soil last year. This year, it's all bumps. It's like walking on moguls. So I've encouraged so many worms to come colonize that soil. And that's a good visual indicator too of how far they'll come because there's no woods around. There's, you know what I mean? Like who knows where these things came from, but they found me underneath the road. They found me underneath the driveway. So they obviously move a great deal. So if you can encourage them to come in, if you give them a food source, which is ultimately that food source is helping you grow your plants better, then they're going to start colonizing that soil. And there's one thing too that I'd very much like to stress. And this lawn is no different from your roses or your vegetables or your trees and shrubs. Like a plant's a plant. They all do the same thing. So it's like all these applications that we would apply to a lawn, it's the same kind of philosophy with our trees and shrubs. When we use the biomass to make the lawn grow, we do the same thing for the roses. A lot of people will do compost for roses in the fall and the spring. We don't ever do that kind of stuff for lawns. So it's like, it's the same kind of deal. They all need similar things. So the applications, the strategies that we use on lawns, they can be applied in other things too. So if we're trying to get worms to come into soil, that's going to benefit your flowering plants as well. Earthworms jack up your available phosphorus in the soil. So they really raise, you know, the middle number there that you're always looking for on your fertilizer. They raise that in the soil naturally. So that encourages roots and flowers really well. And it's also killing disease. Some of these guys are, you know, they like to eat the bad things. So the black spot, powdery mildew, all that stuff, you can spray these on plants and they're pretty effective at knocking some of these bad guys down. But essentially you want worms to colonize your rose garden or your, you know, bed that your trees in or your veggie garden the same way. This is all the same. So the more worms we can get into soil, the more vertical tunnels we get, the more air we have to depth. And if we're dealing with worms making 1 or 2 feet of vertical air, right, in their house, you can see why that's way better than an aerator. If I'm trying to get you air in your soil, an aerator takes a plug out, you know, and it puts it on top. The soil washes back down in the hole. It doesn't, soil structure doesn't change. Nothing really changes, you know, and you're not getting air very deep. If you have a football team running around on your lawn every day, you know, by all means, go nuts, aerate that thing. You could use every bit of help you can get. But for most people, I would concentrate more on putting biomass out there than aerating the lawn. And aeration's a few $100. I mean, you can, each tub of this bio does 10,000 feet for $35. You could get a lot of 10,000 feet. And this is going to help you a lot more moving forward. Now, that being said, if we go and put a pre-emergent on this lawn next spring, I'm going to kill off a lot of the guys that I'm putting out there right now. So when you go this route, if we're trying to make that soil structure better to grow plants in long term, you can't be doing a half and half. You know, it's one or the other. So I tend to look more proactively at things as well. If I've got somebody that comes in, you know, I've got crabgrass every year. Well, crabgrass is a compaction plant. So we go back to the compost, you know. In the fall, you see where all the crabgrass has grown and you cover that whole area with a couple inches of compost. Proactive. If you fluff the soil up, that plant's not going to want to grow there as much. It's got little fat roots that needs a really, really tight soil to hold into. If the soil gets fluffy, it doesn't matter how many seeds are out there. If the soil's not right for that plant, it's not going to grow effectively there, which is what we see with our lawns. That's why we grow more of the crabgrass, the moss, because our soil isn't really good for growing grass.
Hey, Deeks, we've got a question that it might be good for you to address at this point before you talk about your earthworm castings here. And that is, somebody asked if you could recommend an organic weed and feed. Is there such a thing as an organic weed and feed?
So, I mean, the thing I would say to that is there's pre-emergence. You know, it's going to basically not let the plant seed get moisture. So corn gluten is something you can put out there, spring for grassy weeds, fall for broadleafs, winter annuals. You put it down at a very heavy rate. So you end up putting like 20 pounds per thousand, if I remember correctly, of this stuff. And I could be wrong, don't quote me on that one, but I think it's 20 pounds per thousand feet as far as weed prevention is concerned. And a weed and feed too, like, it makes no sense to me, right? I've just screwed up a lot. I'm not wicked smart. It's just, I've screwed up a lot and I've seen some things. So when you talk about a weed and feed, essentially most weeds don't die with one application of a weed killer. Like no matter what you use, you end up hitting it a couple times usually. It's just, they don't work that well. You know, plants have a lot of energy stored in their roots and they can usually push out another time or two. So a weed and feed, you're weakening it and then you're feeding it. So that doesn't, I keep them separate. If fertilizer, fine, but don't, you know, have a different thing for your weeds than, you know, weed and feed is more of a synthetic thing. They just kind of lump everything together. So it's not super effective. At step two, yes, it will damage your dandelions and all that stuff and your chickweeds and all that, but it's going to feed it when it doesn't kill it. And then you also get into this stuff like, organic, usually I would just, for broadleaf weeds and stuff, I'd probably just say iron. You know, it's a really effective broadleaf weed killer. It's something you put down in a spray though. It's not like a granular that you put down with your spreader. But I've had really good luck with iron as an organic way of dealing with, you know, broadleaf weeds. Grassy stuff is a little bit more difficult, you know, but broadleaf iron's really, really good at that. So no weed and feed, but food and then weed killer a couple times probably. And feeding, honestly, we're doing it twice a year. There's no four times, five times a year feeding the lawn. That's ridiculous. Your grass feeds in spring and it feeds in fall. So ideally you don't put, even if you stay synthetic, right? You don't put your fertilizer out until forsythia blooms start falling off. And those yellow flowers start falling off, that's telling you soil temperature's gotten to the point where things are starting to happen. So hold off. A lot of people put their, you know, their step ones out in like March. It's just way too early. And then you reduce the effectiveness, right? Because now it's a little bit wetter in the spring too. So that's a water soluble. It's all salt. So it just kind of washes through. It's not effective. So timing is huge no matter what you do. In organics and synthetics, either way, you kind of just want to do one in spring and one in fall. So I haven't, you know, pushed any fertilizers yet, but in the next week or two, when it starts to cool down, like I said, I'm doing my first lawn this weekend, so we're right there. The nights are cool. You can start to think about putting the food down if you want. I think before that, I would probably stress if you haven't done a soil test to do that. We do them through UMass. I've got papers down here we can give you. But essentially, you know, you take a trowel or a shovel, stick it in the ground, pop it to the side, scoop out a little bit of dirt from 3 to 4 inches down, and you do that 10 or 15 times, get 2 or 3 cups of material in your Ziploc. Scritch it up, let it dry out, send a cup of that to UMass with the paperwork, and then they give you the results in a couple of weeks. And I say this because for me to help, or for any of us to really help you, it's best to know what you're starting with. There's multiple reasons why your soil could be too tight for your roots to get down really deep, you know, and it's very nice to have that little bit of paper with that, you know, tangible stuff right there. Well, this is what it is. And then also, that being said, now you have knowledge on what you do. Like, so let's say you put a half an inch of compost down this next year. Well, you're going to see if you do another soil test, what that's actually done for you. It's something, you know, it's giving you actual information, which is hugely important to kind of give you a baseline reading, know where you're starting with, and to kind of see how you're progressing. Our soils here, they're very devoid in organic matter. And this is kind of why we stress the compost so much. There's gypsum and things like that that you can throw out there too. But our soil structure is very, very devoid of organic matter. So a glacier basically scraped us really good, brought our fluffy to wherever, New York, Pennsylvania, and we got left with sand and clay. And then well-meaning landscapers put down a bunch of loam and topsoil, and all that stuff gets tight. And so there's no organic matter in any of that, which is why it's so hard here, you know? So us stressing the compost is just trying to get us back to where we should be. And that's like, if I remember correctly, like 8% of your soil should be organic matter, right? So our numbers that I typically see are 2 to 4%, wicked low, wicked low. Some people have it high because they used dolomite lime for 30, 40 years. There's a lime that everybody's been selling for forever, basically, that's got a lot of magnesium in it. Magnesium makes soil tighter. But I mean, for the most part, you can assume your soil doesn't have a lot of organic matter, but the soil test would be, you know, ideal for anybody to help you moving forward. It's nice to know what you're starting with. This is earthworm castings, and that's what you kind of want to look for. You feel it if you walk around barefoot. I'm a big barefoot guy. I hate the shoes, so I'm always out there with no shoes on. And you can kind of get a really good feel for the soil like that. You can feel if it's hard. You can feel if you've got the little bumps out there. So you don't kind of got to go digging around. But earthworm castings are your best friend. Like my front lawn there, that's there. I can't take a step without being under multiple earthworm castings. And I think that's what saved me this year. I know that doesn't look in there. Bow. I mean, that lawn, all earthworm castings. You know what I'm saying? So it's one of those things. The earthworms get you the air, the better water structure. Allows you to use that air. You know, compost is going down from above. So you've got essentially organic matter coming down, turn into liquid, making the soil fluffier as it's breaking down through. You've got biomass in the middle that breaks stuff up and chew up the soil, essentially breaking it down. And then you've got worms coming in to eat down, and they're making serious air from below. So that's like your trifecta. You know, that's what you want to look for, is you want to get those earthworms coming in. You want to get that organic matter up. You want to get the soil better to grow grass than it is. Products, bioremedy. All right. So that's the one I showed you. That's a bunch of little microorganisms. He knows exactly what's in there, but he only tells us what 15 of them are or so, because it's proprietary. Doesn't want anybody stealing his blend, which I totally get. I've been using it since about 2004, 2005. I love the stuff. I've had a long history with it. I can't tell you how many plants that saved, everything I get out of our dead pile. That's what's making the compost for me break down so fast too. When you go back to one of these compost applications, if that's how you choose to attack this, essentially in a month, you don't see anything. There's nothing there. It's just the soil, the sand, whatever it was that you saw before you put the compost down. That stuff just goes right through. This really encourages that breakdown. If you're transitioning from a synthetic and trying to do organic and do this, that whole route, go more proactive than reactive. This is what makes the fertilizers work. And again, this guy would be worth a try too. Same deal, 10,000 feet, a little bit cheaper. I just haven't had the time with this product to, you know, have the same confidence. But this stuff, I think he does the Cowboys field. I mean, yeah, so bigger people than I like this stuff. And we just got it this last year, I think last year. Yeah, but I've just started messing around with it and I'm having good luck. So I really like that stuff. But anyway, the biomass is really what you concentrate on. That's what makes the fertilizers work. You know, you hear a lot of people say organics don't work. They're true. They're right. Like a lot of times they just give you a bag of food and there you go. That doesn't work. There's no life in the bag of food. And even if there's a little bit, it's not enough to kind of get things rolling like that. This has a lot more bio than anything else. I mean, it's 100 million colony forming units per gram of most of these things. And it hammers the soil. So my front lawn where I had 1500 feet, I put 10,000 square foot down last fall when I installed it. I go heavy. And that's what's bringing me these results a little bit faster than some people, I think. The heavier you go with the biomass, the faster things turn around. So that's really one of my favorites. I've loved this guy's stuff forever. Microbial soil conditioner was one of the first things that I ever tried, and that stuff brought worms in, and they went through 3 inches of bluestone for a driveway. So I had a puddle go away in a driveway lawn within 5 or 6 months, from being hard as a rock soil with 3 inches of bluestone, inch of topsoil, to all bumps by fall. Phenomenal. That's what we put this stuff down in. Either way, whether you do the fish brew stuff or the bioremedy, dial and spray. There's another one over there. I can't remember. It's chameleon, I think it's called. But you put it on the highest setting, you put it a little plop in there, you mix it up with some water and you just go nuts. Spray everything. You can spray foliage. It's gonna, you wanna soak soil on things. If you're doing your roses, definitely spray the foliage. I mean, anything's gonna appreciate it, but essentially you hammer it. ProGrow, ProStart. ProStart's an awesome starter fertilizer. ProGrow we've had for years, both really, really good. That North Country, I love their stuff. I use their grass seed too. Minimal input grass seed. I think there's a picture of it somewhere. Yep, that one, Cat's Paw. Really like it. It goes farther than the rest of them. It looks more expensive. Let's just say, like, I think the 5 pound bag is $45 as opposed to the 5 pound bag of Cape Cod mix. That's $35. But the Cape Cod mix does 500 feet from scratch. North Country does 1,000. So it goes farther. I still go heavy with grass seed. You know, I'm always one to just go a little bit heavier than I need to go. It seems to work a little bit better, a little faster. You know, people want to see results pretty quick. So a little bit of extra grass seed, as long as you're not coating. I don't want you to smother anything. I don't want you to like have grass seed on grass seed. Don't go too crazy. You can definitely go non-helpful as well with too much grass seed. A reasonable amount of grass seed that's slightly above what they suggest is what I usually go with. Limestone. So we talked about magnesium. This is calcitic lime. Calcitic lime is what you want to be using on lawns. And there's a few different ones that we sell. This one in particular does 5,000 to 10,000 feet. So at 10,000 feet, it's going to keep pH whatever it was at. At 5,000 feet, it'll bump it up a little bit. So that's really, the most inexpensive way to lime. I think it's $20 for 10,000 square feet. You know what I mean? Whereas the regular bags are, they're going to do same weight, same 50 pound bag, different company, different blend. It's just your regular calcitic lime. That stuff does 1200 feet per thousand. You know what I mean? 1200 feet per bag. And it's $10 a bag. So if you've got a bigger size lawn, the $20 bag will go way farther than the $10 bags will. So that, for me, just save the money. Even if you've got a 5,000 square foot lawn, you can use half now, half in the fall. If you do put lime down, do your soil test first if you're planning on doing soil test. The lime is going to screw up the pH on that. So you'd want to take your samples and then you put down your limestone. So, I mean, we're real early on this anyway. Most people aren't liming yet. I haven't seen anybody come in for lime. I haven't done it. I'll probably do it when I do the lawns, but that's really it. So good limestone if you need it. Soil test will also tell you. Some of these towns put stuff in the water that raises pH up. So if you've got town water and you're watering kind of frequently, you might not really need to hammer with lime. So knowing what you need before you go and put everything down is ideal. Just basic stuff. So that's my seed that I like. Any questions?
Dekes, we've got all kinds of questions. Stop your share.
Oh, stop share. All right. Yeah. Okay.
Hey. Hi. We want to see your face bigger. Okay, we've got some questions here, and I'm going to take them top to bottom, ones that we have not already addressed. All right.
Yep.
So we talked about the weed and feed. Somebody said, I picked this year to clear a lot and hydro seed and plant in the spring. Most of the grass is burned. Should we compost and start over?
I mean, when you like 70% toast, I mean, what are you, did you?
Let's assume 70% toast.
Did any weeds grow there?
Well, she's going to have to type that in. So,
Cheryl,
she's got some weeds. Yes.
So, I mean, if they put down a bunch of topsoil or if they, did a topsoil, layer on there, that's going to be tight. The stuff underneath, there was probably a reason why it didn't grow in the first place, I'm guessing. Like, because usually something's cruddy and then they hydroseed onto, they soil it and then hydroseed it and then it gets kind of cruddy again. It's all in the air. There's no air in that stuff. It just compresses. So when you put down, a foot of topsoil or loam, it's going to do that by next year. So that's just getting tighter and tighter. And it's, the roots aren't able to go through that. So ideally, it's kind of how much work do you want to do? If you don't mind the work, then I would say it certainly wouldn't hurt, inch and a half, hammer it. Reseed into that, you're going to kill whatever's below. So it's kind of, if you have sections that look good still, maybe a little shadier, maybe pull down to the half an inch of compost for those and don't kill yourself. I mean, it sounds really awesome to put down an inch and a half of compost on your lawn. And you're like, yeah, this is great. And then the reality of 9 yards of compost shows up in your front lawn. And then you're like, I got to spread 9 yards of compost or 20 yards of compost or whatever it is. It's not an easy day. So just keep it reasonable for yourself. If you're, you know, not able to spread a giant mound of compost, then no, just do a little bit. You know, do just a little bit. Have like a little 3-yard pile drop somewhere that you can pick off of. And, you know, it also changes too if you've got irrigation versus if you're doing it with a sprinkler. Ideally, if we're dealing with a sprinkler, you have a timer and you're not moving the sprinkler at all. I don't want you out there moving sprinklers around trying to water everything. We only do the size that sprinkler can cover. So we're not moving things. We're setting it up and we're leaving it alone for the 3 weeks a month that it's going to take to germinate everything and have it do its thing. So in a perfect world, if you don't have irrigation, that pulls your size way back. And then if you don't have the ability like to do that amount of work, then that pulls it back too. So do what's reasonable and what makes sense. I want you to have 100% success with what you do. So if we're doing it with a sprinkler, get yourself a timer. Because my timers, I like the dummy timers. I set it up in the morning and then I turn it off in the afternoon before I go in the house for a day. That's it. I set it up and I have it soak really well the first thing. I'll usually, you know, 20 minutes, half an hour. And that might change too as you progress, because as the compost breaks down, you're going to puddle faster. You know, so initially that compost will absorb a bunch of moisture. But as you start to progress, you water and, you know, the first one, soak it. After that, every 3 hours, 10, 15 minutes, keep it wet. Don't let it dry out at all. That's the devil if you do that. The mini clover for me came up in like 3 days last year. So that was kind of ideal. Easy peasy. If you're going to choose something that you want to throw down that you have the least chance of screwing up, mini clover is pretty good. It came in awesome for me. I was really happy with the mini clover. It's also, mini clover is wicked easy to tell when it's thirsty. Like for me to tell you how to water a lawn, it's basically, okay, a grass blade is like a book, right? A grass blade has a midrib that goes from stem to stern, like a book has a binding. So if the book's open, if the grass blade's open in the afternoon, when you go in the house, you take a pinch of grass, put your hand. If it's open, you don't water the next day. It's happy. When it's thirsty, it closes like the book closing. If you take a pinch of grass in the afternoon, put it in your hand, and they all look like little elves or canoes, you're going to want to water the next day. And then you kind of pay attention to frequency. What happens is if roots are here, you want water here. And then as roots go down, now we want water here. So that's watering longer and longer, but less frequently as you progress. So you kind of got to be a little malleable as you go on, but that's really your attack strategy.
So Ann wants to know if Ann has been mowing high.
Yep.
Okay. How much should she cut down at a time to so that it's shorter to put compost on the top?
I mean, try not to do more than a third at a time. You know, that's an easy one. You cut down a third, wait a few days, maybe cut it down again a little bit. Just kind of do it gradually. We're still hot, so it's right at the beginning. You know, I'm confident with starting right now, you know, this weekend, but you know, there's no rush. You're right at the very beginning. So take your time and just kind of do it a little gradually. I have come in there and just cut the thing down. It stresses it out. Usually it'll survive, but I would tell you just do it gradually and take it down slow.
Hold up. Eileen says, what is the name of the bioremedy alternative?
This is Fish Brew stuff, and this is Rise and Thrive soil conditioner. Now he also has, this is straight microorganisms, so there's no smell to this. There's a fish emulsifier that he has too. That one's a fertilizer. That's going to have numbers on the front. This one doesn't have any numbers, right? So the fertilizer that they sell has numbers, and that is a little stinky. So if you go that round, it's got like your Neptune's Harvest or anything else that's going to be fish. You know, it's got a little bit of an odor to it. But the Epic and Bold Flow that he has for this are all straight bio blends as well. And I think it goes from $25 for this one up to maybe $45 for the Epic and the Bold Flow. But very good.
Okay. We have a question. Somebody recently had knee surgery. So, of course, they're not going to be out there spreading compost. will using, it says doing the pro growth and bio remedy.
Yeah.
Is that going to help without 100%. The compost?
A food's a really good idea. And the fertilizer and the bio. So like with the organic fertilizers, any of them you do, you want to use the bio remedy or an alternative like the Fish Brew stuff, right? You don't want to let the product be on its own for breakdown. The thing that gets people into trouble is Synthetics are water soluble, so they're made out of salt. Salt breaks down real easy and bypasses soil and gets sucked up into the plant. The organic jobs, they're all water insoluble. So this is part of the, you know what I mean? This is part of the joy of it, is they don't necessarily break down very quickly, but if you have a large chunk of biomass on it, that's gonna break down much faster. So the more life in the soil or the more life you put onto the product, the faster that's gonna break down into available forms for the plant. So that's, it's all, you're always gonna put the bio on top of no matter what you do. ProGrow is and ProStart are probably like the best quality ones that we have. So definitely don't put them down if you, you know what I mean? Like if you don't have a solid, you know, you wanna use something with them. The Espoma, there's a couple of those that have a little bit of bio in it. So, you know, if you're not gonna use anything else, if you're just gonna use the fertilizer, that one might be the one that I would recommend. Because there's like a million coliform units of five or six guys in there, and that's going to help. You know, any little bit helps. So
this is a great question. Right now, my grass is very dry following the drought guides for protecting our water supply from her town. Yep. The lawn work has given us mostly clover over the past year. Right now, even the clover is gone. Our yep. ground is very irregular. I've got one application left of the worm promotion. I'm assuming she means bioworm. Yeah. Should I wait until the ground is wet or, you know, moist to apply it, or can it go over the completely dry area? What would you say?
I mean, they're kind of moving with the water, so I guess I might wait for a rainstorm to put it down. You know, they like the same kind of stuff that we do, food, air, and water. So if you're putting them in a wicked dry environment where there's no moisture at all, you know, I don't know how long they can hang on like that for. So at the very least, we get them into the root mass with some water. So if you're putting it down, maybe put the water on top of it, you know, run the water for an hour or two, just kind of soak it in. I would want something with there. I wouldn't just put them into the total, like, I've had plant issues where I would forget about a plant that's in a pot for, you know, a week or two in the summertime. And then I'd basically go put a bunch of water in there, and then I got root rot. So like I killed off all my good guys by letting it get wicked dry and hot. And then I encouraged the bad guy by just saturating it with water. So what I should have done is probably not let it get wicked dry, you know, water it once a week, that kind of thing. Or just, you know, reapply some good guys without just doing the water. But yeah, I think putting some water down with them would be ideal. I wouldn't want to put them into totally dry soil with just the water coming out of the sprayer.
Mm-hmm. Someone asked about water restrictions. If you have water restrictions and you cannot water at all, you probably shouldn't put down grass seed until it starts to rain regularly, right?
I mean, you're talking weeks for grass seed to germinate. So it's not like a rainstorm or two is going to help you grow a lawn. You know, like there's consistency there. If you don't water that lawn, if that seed, so I had somebody last year that didn't water as consistently as I would have hoped, right? And so the top of her compost would dry out, but the compost as a whole would stay wet. She lost a bunch of seed, like just from she watered every day, but just not from like 10 to 2. You know, so just that 4 hours, it just killed off everything. So if I'm spending money on something, if I'm putting grass seed down that I'm hurt, if somebody gives it to me, all right, you know, go nuts. But if I'm spending money on it, then I want to make sure it works. And I probably wait until the water restriction was lifted.
Okay, we have a question. Is it necessary to screen the compost before applying it, or can you just spread it up?
They've already screened it. Like it's, I mean, hopefully you're not getting large debris. There should be no debris in your compost. So if you get actual sticks and chunks of logs in there, it's probably not compost. So, I mean, the biggest things you get in compost are little bits of stick and stuff like that, which is not a big deal. That's, you know, that's fine. So no, I've never once, in the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of yards of compost I put down in the last few years, not once. So you just put it down,
very good.
Break it out, make it as nice as you can. If you're doing a half an inch, you know, grading rate like this, basically you're kind of going over like this. If you're doing an inch and a half, grading rate like this, you know, like you're letting a little bit more material through the tines that way. And yeah, it's fun. It's exciting and it's good for your back. Just don't push yourself if you're gonna do any of this stuff. You can throw some gypsum down too, that wouldn't hurt. But it's just, you know, anything helps.
Question. Do you recommend Milorganite?
I mean, if you're going from Scott's and you're like, do you recommend Milorganite? I'd be like, anything's better than Scott's, you know, or Johnny Green or whatever. Any synthetic is not ideal. So that's better than any of those. But as a structure, as a system, no, it's not ideal. There's heavy metals in there. It would be good for a boost if you needed a little hit of green. But as a structure that I'm using all the time, no, I would be more inclined to use the Espoma stuff. It's a little bit cheaper too, if I remember correctly. So go a little bit farther for you. And if you do reseed and you use the Espoma fertilizer, you can, any one of their four step can be used as a starter fertilizer. They're all low nitrogen. It's like a 9 for any of them. So you can use that 5,000 square foot bag over the whole lawn and then reseed into that and you're golden.
Okay. How about, do you have to, is there a particular order? Do you have to use pro growth first or bio?
That's a good one. That's my favorite one. Okay. So I've screwed things up for a long time. So the easiest way that I've come up with this, and my eyes aren't any better as I get older, is I'm going to put compost first and then I'm going to put my grass seed down so I can see the grass seed on the compost. Once you put fertilizers down, there's other colors. Now it's kind of a little bit more of a, you know, I'm not going to do as well. So I'm going to put my seed down first. I'm going to put my compost down, seed down. Okay, so this also changes, and I'm ADD, so I bounce around. This changes for half an inch. If you're doing a half an inch of compost, I'll do half my seed underneath, and then I'll do half my seed on top. So if you get a bunch of jerk birds that start eating your grass seed, or if you screw up and don't water it the best way, usually the stuff underneath will do okay. You know, half an inch of compost will retain some water that a lot of times it'll keep that seed alive in situations where the stuff on top, it wouldn't have done so good. So half an inch of compost, seed underneath, seed on top. That's my attack. An inch, inch and a half, 2 inches, then everything's on top. You're pretty much smothering whatever's below. So
if you're using both the Pro Grow and the Bio Remedy, does it matter the order in which you use them?
So for me, I'm always doing the bio last. I might roll the lawn, right? I don't always recommend an aeration. Now, if you're doing this and you've got a slope, it's one of the times where I would say use an aerator, aerate the lawn, you know, get the holes in there. But other than that, I just kind of throw it on top. I totally just had a brain fart and forgot the question. That was the best.
The question is, you mentioned that you always go with the bio remedy last.
Oh yeah. So
the order. Yeah.
Yeah. So you put your seed on the compost and then I'll usually do fertilizer and then I'll roll it. That's where I was going with the aerator. Right. So like I'll roll it. You're putting an inch and a half of material on soil. If we get like last year, I did one that was 20 something yards of compost and we got 6 inches of rain on top of it 4 days later. So it's like, if you don't roll it or do something, a lot of times water will go underneath it and just kind of float it away to the neighbor's yard, which you don't want. So rolling it and then bio. So bio is the last thing. If you bio and then you roll it, everything sticks to the roller, which I've done before a couple times. And that's not ideal. It's a hot mess. So your bio remedy is the last thing you do before you turn the water on. So once you turn your water on, you know, you're rocking, but bio remedy is right before that. So your last thing. And I only do the seed before the fertilizer because I have a tough time seeing the seed if I put it down after the fertilizer. So, I mean, if you got better eyes than me, rock and roll, it doesn't really matter.
Okay. Can compost have a lot of weed seeds in it?
So this is the thing, right? So there's no compost police. There's nobody regulating that word. Nobody cares what you call compost. You can call whatever you want compost and sell it to people. The real deal here is most places you buy material from, it's done in a pile, right? They got a pile and it just sits there. That's not how compost works. Compost should be a windrow, which is essentially a long, low pile, right? It's something that they can get a thermometer in and tell what the temperature is. Because when these little guys chew up the material, they're making it hotter and they're using oxygen. And when they make it too hot and there's no more oxygen, then they die off and bad things grow. So in a pile, you could have any number of things in there and you're not getting consistency. There's no consistency of temperature there. You know, so most things people are calling compost, yeah, there's going to be stuff in there because they're not really composting the material. There's a couple things that I'll usually tell people. I'll say if you walk up to the pile and it smells bad, like bad, you know, like not good, don't buy that. It's not compost. If you walk up to the pile and it's loaded with weeds, no, that's probably not your compost. You know, if it smells like woods kind of dirt, you're rocking. That's good. If it looks like coffee grounds, you go for it. But you be picky. This is the first year we've had compost that's consistent. These people actually make compost and we get it from off Cape. So it's like everything previously was inconsistent. Sometimes you get good stuff, sometimes not so good stuff. So having that consistent supplier has been a world of difference for us. So it's just, I don't have to go out there and smell the compost every week like I had to in previous years, because I've never gone back here and smelled compost or smelled the bad smells, you know? So it's never had a smell. Every break I take, I walk back here, there's no smell. So I'm really happy with this stuff. So yeah, you be careful when you buy compost, because they can sell you whatever they want to sell you. And there's nobody that's going to be like, no, that's wrong. You know, so, and you know, it's the thing with dump material, you get what you get. It's free, you know, you roll the dice. Sometimes you do really well, sometimes maybe not so well.
Yeah, someone asked about the compost from the town dump, and you just summed it up. They care
and they do the best they can, you know, like they're trying to, and they're giving you free stuff. So that's
right. And it is organic matter. And if that's your only option, go for it. But it might have more weeds in it. I know my homemade compost, Dekes, has a ton of seeds of everything in it.
Yeah.
So when I use my homemade compost, I get, you know, weeds, I get tomatoes, I get squash.
So you're not selling compost to anybody. That's all
you
just make sure.
I am not selling it to anyone, and no one would want to buy my compost. How about the bagged compost? If somebody had a very small area and just wanted to get, you know, 4 or 5 bags.
Yeah, I would say get 5. We give a discount at 5 and we give a discount at 10. So at 5 bags, you get 10% off. At 10 bags, you get 20% off.
Yeah.
Bumper crop would typically be the one that I'd recommend. Quaddy is really rich and it's a really good compost, but you kind of have to break it up. It's really tight. Bumper crop, you can just kind of throw it out there. The 2-cubic-foot bumper crop is one of the cheaper bags that we sell. It's $20. All the 1-cubic stuff is like $12.99 kind of deal. So it saves you a little money if you do 2 cubes and you get 5.
Yeah. Well, if anybody has a last question here, we have a couple of minutes. So if you have another question, do type it in chat. And we have some people thanking you, Dekes.
Thank you guys for putting up with me for an hour. I appreciate it.
Another great webinar. This has been recorded. And so there will be a link to this on the events page probably in the next week sometime. It will go up on the events page and you will be able to watch the recording from there. So, you know, and if you want to share the recording, you can tell people once it's up on the events page where to find it.
I also wrote a manifesto.
Oh yeah.
I wrote a manifesto this year. So at least that's what I'm calling it anyway, whatever. It's a little less than 3,000 words, so it's not crazy, but it's cultural practices. So if I haven't given you one, that's something to pick up. You don't need me to be here. It's at the end cap where we've got all the stuff that I'm recommending for you to use anyway. And there's also, that's where the soil test papers are too. Do your soil test, please. Like, help me help you more effectively. Soil test first, and then we move from there.
All right. So your manifesto is only available in the store. We don't email that out.
There's a QR code that we have there, which you can get downloads of it. That's just magic to me. I'm not very internet friendly, so.
Yes. And on the resources page of our website, you can download that. And so you go to resources and I think it says informational handouts. You go there and his is one of those on there. All right. Okay.
Thank you so much, CL. Thank you, everybody. You're awesome.
Thanks so much, Dekes. You're the best.
Kill it. Go get them, guys.